Well, good morning. Well, if you're visiting us today, welcome to New Hope. We appreciate that you chose to come here today. And if you'd like to fill out a thing in front of your Connect card, then please do, and we will contact you, let you know what we do at New Hope beyond Sunday services, so you can have a little more information. But welcome if you're a guest today. Got a few announcements. First one is the women's event next weekend is Giggles and Goodies. Is that what it's called? Yep. And Fawn has tickets for that still. This is the last Sunday beforehand, so if you want tickets today, buy them from Fawn. She's right over there. She'll be peddling those tickets all day and beyond, potentially. And that's for the comedian Amy Barnes, and there'll be the Kona Ice Truck will be coming after that as well, and I think that's included in your ticket, so excellent. 1040i, so last week you heard about the need that 1040i had for money to build a library in Nyonan, the village in the Ivory Coast. Well, you guys stepped up as normal and surpassed the amount that was needed for the library, so they will be building that library based on what was collected last week, which is great. In fact, you surpassed it so much that there's extra money, so now they've got to figure out what to do with the extra, but Tim will talk more about that as time goes on. It'll probably go towards a sponsorship of some of the kids that are in that village on an ongoing basis to help them with living expenses through the rest of the year. But excellent job on getting that done. And there's also another insert in the bulletin today. I've got a lot of paper. And it talks about, there's still a project pledge. So if you want to pledge specifically for the Nyonan village, then you can still do that on this form, because it all will go towards that village. But also there's a monthly pledge. And, you know, nonprofits really need the monthly pledge. That helps them with the operations that they do on a month-to-month basis, helps them keep the doors open, the lights on, and all the trips that have to occur before the February trip. So Mike goes over there on a regular basis, and he plans the trips. And so, you know, that helps pay for the stuff like that that happens on a regular basis. So pledging on a monthly basis is as important as giving to the specific project. So that's an insert in the bulletin. If you want to do that, just fill it out and put it in the offering a little later. Fresno Grizzlies. So August 12th, there is a Grizzly game. It's the Christian Fellowship night. It's always a good night. Hopefully it won't be as hot as it was last week, or is continuing to be, because that will make it a little tricky. But the Christian Fellowship night means that there's going to be a game, and then there'll be a concert after. Johnny Diaz is going to be singing after in the concert. He sings that song, Breathe. I don't know if you know that. It's a great song. So he'll be doing a concert after the game, and then there'll be fireworks at the end of that. So it should be a good evening. There's a $16 a ticket, so you get the ticket. You get a free hat. Well, it's not technically free, but it's a championship hat that the Grizzlies will give you. Plus, you get the concert and fireworks. So $16 is not too bad for an evening out for that. They're selling tickets out in the pavilion out there. Angel is selling tickets. Hope groups. We should have clipboard. Yep. So hope groups are starting back up. They've got a meeting on, when is it? August 7th, 12:15. So next Sunday, there'll be a meeting for anyone that leads hope groups, anyone that's interested in becoming a group leader. If you are interested, sign up on the form. There's also another sheet, so look behind the hope groups as well. So if you're interested in that, it doesn't lock you in either. It just means that you're interested enough to come to a meeting and find out a little bit more about being a hope group leader. That's the small groups here at New Hope. Grief share, that's another thing on the clipboard. Grief Share will be starting back up August 16th and 17th. There'll be a morning and an evening one. Sue Krause is the one in charge of that, so make sure you see her if you want more information about Grief Share. Kids will be going back to school over the next 2 to 3 weeks. So if you happen to be going to do school supply shopping for kids, there's a need for kids' ministry. If you just want to add something onto your list, there's specific things that Jennifer's put in here that we're going to need on an ongoing basis for the children's ministry. So if you want to throw something extra in your basket when you're buying kids' supplies, then we'd really appreciate that. Speaking of kids camp, there is a surf camp. The camp that the Pastor Feed funds is starting today. They're going up today after third service, and there's 13 of them plus two counselors going. So we want to keep them in our prayers this week as they go through some pretty in-depth study at camp, You know, that age group is kind of tricky, the fourth, fifth, and sixth graders, because they want to play a lot, but they also know that they need to take certain things seriously. So we just pray that they will get a good balance through that week and learn a lot of stuff. The people that are doing it up at Heartland Camp always do a fantastic job. So I'm sure that they will learn a lot. But keep them in your prayers this week as they spend time up at camp. There's also an insert here for Prism Fellowship. Prism Fellowship is an organization that we support pretty heavily here at the church. And it's one that we really believe in a big way. And I can, from personal experience, I can tell you that volunteering for Prism Fellowship is a very rewarding thing to do. You know, we used to do Bible studies at Coalinga. Frank Hicks, for those of you that know Frank Hicks, I used to drive him to Coalinga. I started off just driving him because he couldn't drive anymore. Ended up, after he stopped going, I was still going and doing Bible study with the men in Coalinga at Pleasant Valley Prison. Very, very worthwhile ministry and very, very rewarding, not just for the men there, but for the people that go in. You know, it's not something where you have to know a ton about the Bible, where you have to be very versed in everything that's involved in a Bible study. You'll find that the Bible studies kind of take on a life of their own. The men there know a lot. They have a lot of time to read this stuff and to study it. So in many ways, they'll teach you a lot. But what it does do is it gives them an opportunity to get out of their cells and off the yard and to gather together as Christians in a more formal way and do Bible studies. So without that opportunity, they kind of have to form their own groups on the yard, and that can get a little bit difficult at times. So if you're interested in Prism Fellowship in any capacity, then there's information about how to get involved in that on the insert in the bulletin. But I would encourage people to do that if you've ever had a thought about doing it. I think that's all the announcements. Tim is obviously not here today. He's in San Luis Obispo. He's doing a wedding this weekend and decided it was too hot over here, so he just stayed. And who can blame him, frankly? So, prayer requests. We have prayer requests. Charlene Dooms continues. She's going to be continuing treatment for her leukemia. Numbers were way down, which was great. Not quite as low as the doctors wanted, so she's starting on the next round of treatment, so we just got to keep her in our prayers. Rhonda Davis, some of you will know Rhonda. She tripped and fell midweek. She broke four ribs, punctured a lung, broke a bone in her shoulder and a thumb, all on the right side. So that was a very painful experience for her. I went and visited her yesterday in the hospital. She actually got released yesterday. So she's back home, so we'll keep her in our prayers. That basically, the important thing is that they can manage the pain well while she's at home, because they let her go because, you know, it seemed to be well managed at the time. But obviously, that's exceptionally uncomfortable, and there needs to be a lot of pain management. So keep her in your prayers and hope for a quick healing for her. Also, I got a couple of notes passed to me. The Brown family would like to thank everybody in the church family for the prayers. The grandson, he's doing great, which is great news. He came over here, got diagnosed and treated, and went back, and you know, things are going great. And that's really good news, for him and for that family. Also, Bob and Ian asked me to say a prayer for Mike and Sharon O'Connell and all the others that evacuated from the Pray the Fire yesterday. I think there was also a fire at North Fork, and there was a lot of fires going on yesterday. So you know, also keep the residents in prayer, but keep the firefighters in prayer as well. I mean, firefighting in these temperatures must just be a very, very difficult thing to do. But they've been exceptionally busy recently. Okay, I'd like to ask our ushers to come forward for the weekly tithes and offering. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're just grateful for this day. We're grateful for every day that you give us, and we're just grateful to be servants of yours, Lord. We just pray for open hearts for today's message and open minds as we listen to today's message, and we just pray for those that are in need, not just the ones that were mentioned, but specifically today, Charlene and Rhonda, and we give praise for healing and for ongoing effects that we know that prayer has. And we thank you for the opportunity to be able to pray to you for what we need in our lives. And we see you answering these prayers on a regular basis. We pray for the firefighters that are fighting fires right now. We just pray that they are safe and that they can effectively do their job with as few encumbrances as possible. We pray for the residents that are affected by these things. It's very difficult for them to watch often as their house burns down and all their belongings are gone. So we just pray that you protect the communities up in the mountains. We pray for the kids as they go to camp. We pray that they will have open minds and they will find balance between play and study so they can come back with new information and just on fire for you, Lord. We thank you for the generosity of this church as always. There are so many things that can be done with the money that's raised here, and we just pray for the village of Neonen, and we just are glad that we are able to bless it in the way that we have been able to. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, the first thing you notice today is probably that we have a little extra furniture on the stage. No, I'm not going to have a tea party. We're not going to do a round table discussion. It's not set up for something later. What it is, this table and chairs is a representation of what we're going to talk about today. The kitchen table and chairs is a representation of family. Anyone that's taken Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University knows that in the first video that he plays, he has a kitchen table with chairs around it, and he talks about the time when he and his wife hit rock bottom financially after flying high for a while. And they sat around a kitchen table trying to figure out which bills they can and cannot pay until finally they signed their bankruptcy papers on the kitchen table. And this piece of furniture became very meaningful to him through that process. So I basically stole the idea from him, but now I'm going to take it a step further. See, we're going to look today at all the different things that happen around a kitchen table. If you were to take pictures of all the different things that were happening over the years around a kitchen table, and often we do when we have events that include it, but if you were to take pictures or picture in your mind all the different things that happen, sometimes it would just be as simple as a family sitting around the table eating dinner. Other times it would be kids sitting around the table doing homework. Sometimes there'd be a birthday cake in the middle of it. Other times there'd be little kids pushed up close in high chairs so they can join the rest of the family. And at times there may be bills spread on the table and your checkbook out as you try and figure out which bills are payable and which ones are more of a struggle. There may even be papers on the table that start an adoption to add another person to the family table. On the other side of the coin, there may be divorce papers that are being read carefully before signature, before breaking up a family. A lot of things touch the table over the years because the fact is that life happens around the kitchen table. I look at our own kitchen table at home, and it's beginning to look a little worn around the edges these days from the day it was delivered 16 years ago. The edges are worn, and there's writing ingrained in the wood where one of the kids pushed too hard with a pencil with a single sheet of paper protecting the wood underneath. Scratches and pitting make it look very different these days. And my wife and I look at this table sometimes and we say, maybe we should get this table refinished. After all, it's a good table. But then we look at the kids and say, I don't think they've finished their systematic assault yet on the table. So maybe we'll wait. But at the time we find each scratch, each stain, and every time a glass of milk spreads itself across the table, in that moment, we're frustrated. But ultimately, it becomes part of the history of our family, ingrained on our furniture. It shows that life is happening around our table, that there's activity, along with it comes stains and scratches and dents. But more than any other piece of furniture, in my opinion, the kitchen table sees more of family life. So we should advise married couples that are first getting married, get a good kitchen table, because you're going to need it. It's going to see a lot of action. So today we're going to continue with the Psalms, as we've been doing through this year. But we're going to show Tim up this week because we're going to do two Psalms and not one. Takes him 3 weeks to do one sometimes. We're going to do two, and we'll probably get out early because we seem to be really getting through this. So we're going to look at Psalms 127 and 128. And we're going to look at them both together because they kind of tie together well in a progression from one to the other. And they're both written under the wisdom of Solomon. Now, there is some argument that Solomon didn't write these. It starts off, says, of Solomon at the top, but there's some question as to whether David might have written it for his son Solomon or whether somebody else did for Solomon as well. But for the purposes of today, we're going to assume that Solomon wrote them because that seems to be the most common thought. And what it does is it supplies a blueprint for the building of a home or a family. So let's imagine I decided to build a house. And I went to a home improvement store, and I got a whole bunch of stuff that I needed. And I worked to put this all together. I poured foundations, I cut and put up framing. I strung electrical wiring and put pipes in for plumbing. I'm confident that the result would not be livable. But I know some of you here could probably build a pretty solid house, as we've seen year over year in the Mexico missions. But the one thing I'd be missing, other than general experience and skill, is a blueprint. We need a blueprint to make things work properly. The Bible is a blueprint for our lives. But today we're just going to be looking at a small portion of it that relates to family. So today let's start reading through them. First, we'll read through both together, and then we'll look at the four parts that these two psalms separate themselves into fairly naturally. So we'll start with Psalm 127. Unless the Lord builds the house in vain and the builders labor in vain, unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat, and he grants sleep to those he loves. Children are a heritage from the Lord. Offspring, a reward from him, like arrows in the hands of a warrior, are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame and when they contend with their opponents in court. Psalm 128, blessed are all who fear the Lord, who walk in the obedience to him. You will eat the fruit of your labor. Blessings and prosperity will be yours. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Yes, this will be the blessing for the man who fears the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your lives. May you live to see your children's children. Peace be on Israel. The first part of the four that we'll look at is covered by the first two verses in Psalm 127, and that is creation or building of a home. And I'm not just talking about physically building a house, as in bricks and mortar, but building a home. We should really make sure we understand in our minds before we go forward the difference between a house and a home. An apartment is a home. A house is a home. But a house is also a physical building. An apartment's a physical building. But there's a difference. A home is something that you build that's very personal to you. It's personal to your family. And it doesn't matter if it's a huge house, an apartment, a tent, or a hut in a village in Africa. It's a home. Your home. And that's where you go to take refuge from the world, to regenerate, to connect with those that you love, or to find comfort. This is why people's houses, or when people's houses get broken into, and things get rummaged through and messed up, there's a very strong feeling of total violation when that happens. And it's beyond just the breaking of locks or the stealing of cash or TVs or whatever. It's something more than that. It's an invasion into your personal space, your family's sanctuary. It's an invasion into your home, not just your house. The key point here is that not that we decorate our property to create a nice home and that we cook delicious meals to nourish our family, or even create a comfortable space to live in. Those are all important things. But it's the Lord that should be the center of our home. The work to do all these things is in vain, as written in the first verses. In vain unless the Lord is the center of it all. This expression, in vain, is emphasized three times by Solomon, so he's clear about the need to have a good foundation for the house. Joshua made this decision when he outlined what God had told him to the Israelites, and he gave them a choice. Joshua 24, 14, 15 says, "Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in the land that you are living, but as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." So he says, in our home, we're going to serve God. He will be the focus and the hub around which the family revolves. Many tables like this around. God and Jesus should be in the center of the table with the family surrounding it and revolving around it. Everything that we do, everything that we decide, every move we make should be with God in mind. This is the key to stopping a home from crumbling and a defense against the evil one who is always working against our families. So we've covered the physical and the emotional components of a home. And the second of the four parts that we'll look at is children. Chuck Swindoll says about children in a godly home, "If a relationship with God is the foundation of a home, then children are the bricks and mortar. We build on the foundations of our home with the children that God blesses us with through whatever method he sees fit." My wife Jennifer and I first built on our foundation of our home through adoption. We flew to Russia twice. More accurately, we flew to Siberia twice in the winter. So that was pretty cold. And we experienced one of the most incredible experiences of our lives. We became parents for the first time in a courtroom in the frozen city of Novosibirsk. So God doesn't have just one way to provide bricks and mortar. But then God also knew the terror that I felt suddenly becoming a parent of a two-year-old that didn't understand any English, that we had to get 16 hours from Moscow to Los Angeles on an airplane. And I just want to go off on a tangent a little bit here and talk about adoption, because we don't really talk about it too much around here. I believe that Jen and I were supposed to adopt. I believe that was God's plan. We'd talked about it before we got married, and we wanted to start a family at one point, but we just didn't seem to have much luck, and even science intervention didn't help. So we decided to adopt first and revisit biological children later. So that's what we did. We went through the process, which was long, which is common for most international adoptions, and probably still is. And then after that, through the efforts of more treatments, we were blessed with two biological children, our daughters. But God has a plan for Peter, our son, as he does for everybody, but there was a reason that he wasn't supposed to be there. We needed to focus our attention on the adoption and put our plan for biological children on hold for a while. People often say how much it must have been a blessing to him that we adopted him. And I agree, while his situation is immeasurably better than it would have been, I can't begin to tell you the blessings that we felt from it. If you've ever considered adoption, or you know anyone that has, and you wonder how it works, we have a great resource for it here in our church. And many of you probably don't know this, but Debbie Mueller is the executive director of Children of Prague here in the Fresno area, an adoption agency, and also an adoptive parent. She's not here today, but when you see her next, if you're interested, chat with her if you have any interest, no matter how small. But we get back to Psalm 127. Children are described here as a heritage or a gift. And the Hebrew word that heritage comes from actually means property or possession, or that which is shared or assigned. But it isn't referring to the children as our property or our possessions. They're God's property, and they've been assigned to us here to raise up, to become godly people, and follow the path that God has laid out for them. It really puts a whole different perspective on parenting when you think about it in that way, when you think about the fact that these are God's children assigned to us through his assignment, which could be childbirth, it could be adoption, it could be foster care, or it could be just children that are present in your lives that you have an influence over, and it can help them shape them for the future. The second part of the verse is that they're a reward from him. A reward is good. It's something that we earn in his eyes. But what we have to notice about this verse is that it simply says children. It doesn't say some children or selected children, some, but it says all. Surprise pregnancies are not a surprise to God. They're not accidents in God's eyes. It's only how we decide as people to view the unexpected and the choices that we make after that. But the third description here that we see is that children are like arrows in the hands of a warrior. We must, as warriors, aim carefully and direct children because they cannot be self-directing. Those of you that were here on Tuesday night for the marriage Bible study, Tim talked about the fact that animals, when they're born, they have instinct. They know what to do. You see it in them. They kind of know what they're supposed to do when they're born. People are not like that. They don't have the same instincts. So we have to direct them because people are born sinners. It's the nature of people. So without direction and without parental guidance or somebody influencing their lives, there won't be a foundation that needs to exist in their life. Proverbs 22:6 says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and even when he's old, he will not depart from it." This is the foundation. It becomes a default when they know the fundamentals of God and what he wants them to do. Building this foundation takes time. And I don't mean it takes a long period of time. It does. But in this context, I mean it takes time that you have to spend with these children. In a survey that was done by the Pew Institute, it was estimated that between 1965 and 2011, the amount of time that parents spend with their kids has increased, both for men and women. The women's number has only increased a little bit, because from 1965 to 2011, a lot of the women went to work as well that weren't working before. But the men's number has almost tripled, and that's encouraging. But we also need to consider what the quality of time spent with children is. And I'm guilty here as anybody else. Do we find ourselves just in the presence of our kids? What are they doing when we're with them? What are we doing when we're with them? Screens get in the way a lot. I'm spending time with my kids, but we're looking at two different screens. Do we actively do things with them? Do we do things that build memories, that give them confidence? And more importantly, build a relationship with God. And a relationship that will act as a foundation when they need to draw on it later in life. Verse 5 then continues with the arrow analogy, stating that those whose quiver is full of them will not be put to shame when they contend with their opponents in court. In other words, a parent's children will be a testimony to them in public. It will be a testimony to their integrity and their honor. Speaking of a quiver full of arrows, there's a story about a group of expectant fathers who are in a hospital room, waiting room, where their wives are in process of giving birth. A nurse came in and announced to one man that his wife had just given birth to twins. "That's quite a coincidence," he said. "I play for the Minnesota Twins." A few minutes later, a nurse came in and announced to the other man that he was the father of triplets. "Well, that's amazing," he said. "I work for 3M Company." And at that point, the third man slipped off his chair and lay down on the floor hyperventilating. And somebody asked him if he was ill. He said, "No, I just work for 7-Up. So someone wisely wrote, "No culture has ever been able to provide a better shipyard for building stormproof vessels for the journey of man from cradle to the grave than the individual nourished in a loving family." And I would suggest to that quote could be added, a loving family who looks to God first. The third of the 4 points that we're going to look at today is the leadership of the home. This examines further the concept of raising kids in a godly way, leading them to walk in obedience to God. And if we as parents or grandparents or caretakers do this, Solomon talks about the blessings that we will receive. We all try to do this. We try to walk in obedience ourselves. And we try to have a healthy fear in the Lord. And when I say healthy fear, I mean the type of fear that prevents us from falling too often to temptation and helps us to make more decisions that are more appropriate to the path that God wants us to follow. But we try to do these things and model the right thing for our kids to do. Because whether we like it or not, or whether it's even occurred to us or not, we are always the mentors for our kids. Or frankly, to any children that we spend any time with. They see what we do. And no matter how many times we tell them what the right thing to do is, without us modeling it, our words don't mean anything. Tony Dungy, who was a former coach of the Indianapolis Colts, he wrote a book that I love called The Mentor Leader. And in one part he writes, "I find it helpful to remember that people are watching me and how committed I am to the things that I profess to believe and whether those are worthy things. As I live my life seeking to be a good role model in exercising mentor leadership, I hope that others can see my faith at work and have it affect their faith as well." Tony Dungy was definitely a family man, and this can be applied just as easily to the family home as it can be to the football field. In the past, I've done a workshop for my employees using this book as a basis. The flight instructors that work in my business are mentors by default. And they're mentors whether they want to be or not. And they're mentors whether they know they are or not. Student pilots look to them as an example of what a professional pilot looks like, acts like, and does. And I did this workshop because I realized when I was listening to them talk and see how they acted around students, I realized that they didn't know that they were mentors. They didn't think of themselves as mentors because they weren't the chief instructor, the assistant chief instructor. But what the students saw in them would be what they would mirror as professional pilots down the road. And I felt an urgent need to tell them this. And I also needed them to make some changes about the way they acted in uniform. Not everybody wants to be a mentor, but so many of us are and they don't even know it. In the same way, we as parents are mentors to our kid, whether we're intentionally doing it or not. How many times have you heard a kid say, "Mom or Dad, I want to be just like you when I grow up"? And when we hear this, we should be thinking, what does that look like? Do I want them to be just like me when they grow up? And dads, I give you a particular word of caution. There's been a very large number of articles, from tabloid articles up to papers in psychology journals, about the fact that girls tend to marry men that are very much like their fathers. Every time I read this, it gives me introspection, and it should. Is that a good thing? If we don't think it is, then we need to be changing ourselves. We need to become the man that we want our daughters to marry, because frankly, this may be the only influence that we have over that decision, but it's one that has been proven. The good news is that it's easy to lead. The hard part is determining what that leadership will look like. We can lead down the wrong path just as easy as we can lead down the right path. If we want to help our kids to be godly people, then here's a statistic from a study in the 80s. It's kind of old, but it may be safe to assume that it's true now, if not slightly worse. But the study disclosed that as both parents attend church on a regular basis, 72% of their children will remain faithful. If only dad attends regularly, then it drops to 55%. But if only mom comes, it plummets to 15%. If neither parent attends and you just drop the kid off for church, then only 6% remain faithful. Now, these are simplified, and I'm not quite sure where they drew all this information from. And it's not designed to offer no hope to single moms who bring their kids or moms that come alone and bring their kids with them to church on a regular basis. But the X factor in all this is your relationship with God. He can change the odds significantly through this by having the right relationship and leadership at home. not just at church. Guidance through faith at home, and not just on Sundays at church, can significantly change the outcome of the faith of your child. What this study does do, however, is provide a truth that dads can have a much stronger influence over the faithfulness of their children than many of them want to have. But for the dads out here today, that's good news for you. The picture Solomon paints in Psalm 128, so we'll move on to 128, is the ideal family scenario. And in times it was written, the traditional home had a man as the head of the household. And so that's the way it's portrayed in Psalm 128. And yes, we're well aware that households look different now a lot of times, and that the single-parent homes, and often mom or dad is playing the parts of both parents, providing nurturing, leading, mentoring, and often this is incredibly hard from day to day. So I'll start by saying that God should be the head of all households. And whatever roles each parent or one parent takes, it should be with God in mind and at the center of the table at all times. This is where the stability is. This is where the strength is. And this is where the answers and guidance for every situation can come from. But here's another important point. God provides in many different ways. He provides to those who need help. We're God's church, and we're here for those in need. We're here for the sick. We're here for those who just need a word of encouragement or prayer. And I can tell you that we have men in this church who day in, day out, help to mentor and shape the lives of kids in this church as if they were their own. I would encourage any single parent or any parent that's looking for help in this area to look to this church. Let God work through his people. Let God work through his servants when you need help. We're also a family, God's family. So we see in verse 3 the words the table. So even the wisdom of Solomon knew the importance of the family table, the picture of the family gathered around. Notice that the children are not described as branches of the vine, because the wife is described as the vine, but they're olive shoots, completely different plant, independent of parents. The emphasis is that they are individuals. They'll have their own lives. They will go their own way. They'll have their own offspring. They will not be tethered to their parents. And it's an important distinction that our children are different than us. It's easy as a parent to have high hopes for our kids in some area that perhaps we never quite capitalized on ourselves, or to redeem our own broken dreams, so-called narcissistic parenting. But here in Psalm 128, the uniqueness of our children over ourselves is highlighted. Our children should and will follow their own dreams and desires and not ours. The last part of the four that we're going to look at is the blessings beyond the child-rearing years. Verses 4 through 6 in 128, they break down the personal blessing, which is verse 4, may the Lord bless you. They break down the blessing of the community from your offspring, verse 5, the prosperity of Jerusalem. And finally, the benefit more universally in the nation, and verse 6 mentions Israel. This is the time that we look around and see the fruit of our labors, the rewards for the active and not passive parenting. The rewards of being intentional about raising the next generation. The youngest members of our family, with our own children, grandchildren, nieces, nephews, young cousins, or kids that we just have a relationship and an influence over, are the future of this nation and then the future of our church. And I mean the church in a universal sense, the Christian faith. But also over there on the other side of the fountain is the future of this church. In 1979, J. Allen Blair wrote in the Discovery Digest, during the past 10 years, an army of over 30 million people have come to the United States. Because they have arrived one by one, appearing innocent and harmless, we have not suspected their potential power. Someday soon, however, we shall awaken to the fact that this army has taken over our nation. They will publish our papers. They will operate our radio and television stations, control our churches and teach in our schools. They will capture Washington and dominate the federal government, as well as administration of each state. They will take over business and industry, including the control of atomic energy. Complete authority will be in their hands. And all that will remain for us will be to submit and die. This army, of course, is an army of children. We have the power to decide whether these future conquerors of our country are to be pagan or Christian. Well, that was 37 years ago that was written. So how has that army of children that he was referring to, that are already doing many of the things that he talked about, how has that gone for this country? How many references recently have we heard about our nation being at an all-time low point for its faith and its people, with Christianity being attacked on all sides by special interest groups and even legislators? God now can't enter the classrooms and barely the workplace. The very structure of marriage has been warped through the legal leadership of this country. How has that gone over the last 37 years? But I suppose many of those kids are still fairly young to be in the highest positions of influence yet. But the good news is that we have an opportunity to shape the future generation, to provide a new army of people that will take over the infrastructure of this country through business, government, the press, and our schools. Our children and grandchildren will grow and they will find their place in the world. Some may serve diligently in critical roles in society, and some may have leadership in positions of influential positions that can change the course of communities, and even the country. But if they do these things with a foundation that was poured early on in life, a foundation that was built in the home and not just a Sunday school room, then they will find their faith. They'll find their faith will influence them through everything that they do. And eventually they will have children. And since people tend to raise their children the way they were raised, assuming it was a reasonable childhood, they will pass along the legacy that was started. Before I wrap this up, I want to talk about family in general. We've focused heavily on children and raising children through Psalms 127 and 128, which is the focus of those Psalms. But family as a whole can be a challenging subject. We're fond of the expression, you can't choose your family. Well, that's true. We choose who it is we want to marry, and that choice is a very important decision in our lives. It's a process that when we get married, we hope that the bond will be a very powerful one. But it's not a relationship that happens by default. It's intentional. Our relatives, however, are in our lives by default, but not by accident. No, we cannot choose our family, but God does. I said earlier, there's no accident to God. He designs our lives, and along with it, he designs our families. Our siblings, our parents, our cousins, aunts, uncles, grandparents are part of the family that God has assigned us to be in, and there are challenges in families, and there are problems between family members, and often issues seem totally insurmountable. But God has assigned us to be with these families, and as Christians, we have to look at the tough family situations sometimes and decide if we're going to be the light in the dark, if we're going to be the bridge over the rift. Former Beatle George Harrison died in December 2001. During his final days, his wife and child and his sister Louise were at his bedside. It was Louise's presence that was especially poignant. You see, she and George had been feuding with each other for almost 40 years. The feud began when Louise opened a bed and breakfast named A Hard Day's Night. The rift was healed only when George realized that he would probably die from his cancer, and Louise reports that their reconciliation was difficult but satisfying. We sort of held hands like we used to. We used to talk for hours about life and God and the universe, she said. We were able to look into each other's eyes again with love. It was a very, very positive and loving meeting. This story is a good one, but there's an underlying element of tragedy to it. 40 years of a relationship that was lost over a relatively minor dispute, and it was terminal illness that brought them back together. But time was too short at that point. The news of cancer helped to melt away the past, but it doesn't have to be this way for so many families. And we need to look at our kitchen table, beyond the parents and kids sitting around it as portrayed in Psalm 128. And we need to pull up more chairs. Make room for all family because God brought us together. And if we work together as families to make sure the next generation will be an army of God, we'll have better odds of laying the firm foundation together. We cannot be distracted by things in life that take away from this task. And finally, in his book, The Eye of the Storm, Max Lucado wrote, Clovis Chapel, it's a good name, Clovis Chapel, we're in a Clovis Chapel right here, and a minister from a century back used to tell the story of two paddle boats. They left Memphis at about the same time, traveling down the Mississippi River to New Orleans. As they traveled side by side, sailors from one vessel made a few remarks about the snail's pace of the other vessel. Words were exchanged, challenges were made, and the race was on. Competition became vicious as the two boats roared down through the deep south. One boat began falling behind. It didn't have enough fuel. There'd been plenty of coal for the trip, but not enough for the race. The boat dropped back, and an enterprising young sailor took some of the ship's cargo and tossed it into the ovens. When the sailors saw that supplies burned as well as coal, they fueled their boat with the material that they'd been assigned to transport. They ended up winning the race, but burning their cargo. God has entrusted cargo to us. Children, spouses, friends, family. Our job is to do our part in making sure that the cargo reaches its destination. Yet when the program takes priority over people, people often suffer. How much cargo do we sacrifice in order to become the number one slot? How many people never reach the destination because of the aggressiveness of a competitive captain? Distractions take us away from God's path in our family lives. So take a look at the kitchen table and think about the history that it tells. Think about the future stories that you want it to tell and cherish the times that we're gathered around it as a family, not just immediate family, but extended family. And for anyone that has a rift between them and others in their family, keep a chair open for them. Invite them back to the table. And don't lose time that you wish you'd had later. Let's pray. Lord God, we give thanks for family. We just pray that as families, we will put you in the center of the table, the hub around which the family can revolve. We just pray that we can come together as families and act as a team to help build the foundation that's needed in the younger generation. We give thanks for all the resources that we have as a church as a whole to help families and to build strong foundations in the kids that we have here. And we pray for the kids of New Hope and the families that attend. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Have a wonderful day.